Thank you, everyone. Good morning. Happy Friday. And with that, I will turn it over to our clerk, Joanne, to do roll call.
Thank you. Good morning. So if I can just ask everybody to unmute themselves and let me know that they are present. Chopowick?
Present.
Thank you. Demirla has sent in her regrets. Dyes?
Present.
Drake? Drake? Okay. Fletcher?
Present.
Yeah. Innes?
I'm present.
Juan has sent in regrets. Keith?
I'm present again. Did you do twice for me or did I hear it wrong? It doesn't really matter. I'm here.
I think I might have. I apologize. Hyatt?
Good morning.
Jackson?
Present. Good morning.
Kelleher? Kelleher? And Fruitsa? Fruitsa?
I hear. Present.
Thank you.
Good, Joanne? Yes.
We are good. Sorry. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. We respectfully acknowledge that the lands we are situated on are traditional territories of lands, in particular, those of the Mississaugas of the Credit, as well as the Anishinaabe of the Williams Treaty First Nations, the Haudenosaunee, and are now home to First Nations, Inuit, and Métis people. Toronto and Region Conservation Authority appreciates and respects the history and diversity of the land and is grateful to have the opportunity to work and be in this territory. Can I have a mover, please, for the minutes of the meeting held on April the 1st? No joke. Moved by Dr. Chopowick. All those in favor? Any opposed? That carries. Are there any disclosure of pecuniary interest in the general nature thereof? Vice Chair Heath? No? Good. Okay. There are no delegations or presentations or correspondence. Section 1, items for Board of Directors action, 7.1, 2022 unfunded priorities. 7.2, 2022 TRCA budget.
I'd like to pull those, the first two, 7.1 and 7.2.
Okay. 7.3, acquisition from 2022988 Ontario Inc. 7.4, agricultural lease renewal, former Lamont property.
I'd like to pull that, Madam Chair.
Okay, Councillor Dyes.
Thank you.
7.5, Royal Canadian Legion Mackenzie Branch lease renewal.
I'd like to pull that, Madam Chair, please.
Okay. 7.6, proposal from the City of Brampton to lease the McVean farm site. 7.7, lease renewal, McVean Incubator Farm. 7.8, award of request for tender for supply and delivery of various armor stone and riprap for Humber Bay Park East Revivement Project. 7.9, award of request for tender for Gaffney Park Erosion Control and Drainage Project, City of Toronto. 7.10, award for the request for proposal design build services for the 193 to 195 Hudson Drive Slope Stabilization Project. Can I have a mover, please, for items 7.3, 7.6, 7.7, 7.8, 7.9, and 7.10?
Sorry, Madam Chair, could I hold 7.8? Sorry.
Yep.
Thank you.
So all of those without the exception of 7.8, moved by Dr. Drake. All those in favor? Any opposed? Carries. Section 2, 8.1, application for permit pursuant to Section 28-0-1 of the Conservation Authorities Act, Minister Zoning Order, Ontario Regulation 599-21. 8.2, application for permit pursuant to Section 28-0-1 of the Conservation Authorities Act, Minister's Zoning Order, Ontario Regulation 698-20. 8.3, award of request for tender for Coatswith Cut Channel Dredging Project, City of Toronto. And I have a mover, please, for 8.1, 8.2, and 8.3. Moved by Councillor Jackson. All those in favor? Any opposed? That carries. Section 3, 9.1, Peel Region Urban Forest Best Practice Guide. 9.2, 2021 Year-End Financial Report. Jack, you're muted, but do you want to hold 9.2? A mover for 9.1, please. Moved by Vice Chair Heath. Oh, he's waving his hand. Do you want to unmute?
I would like, well, actually, all I would like, 9.1, I move it. I'd like to add a motion that the TRCA send it to all the municipalities in our jurisdiction. This is such a good report. That's I just like it sent to them all by the TRCA. I think we should all read it. I think there are people on each council who would appreciate the work Peel did. So if that's friendly.
Can we take that? Yeah. Can we add that as direction for staff to do that on behalf of the board, please?
Sure, Madam Chair.
So moved by 9.1 and 9.2, moved by Vice Chair Heath. All those in favor? Any opposed?
I did want to pull 9.2.
Okay. 9.2 for Jack. So 9.1, all in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. Section 4, 10.1, delegated permits for receipt staff approved and issued. Moved by Councillor Hyatt. Is he on here? Yep, there we go. Any opposed? Carried. Are there any items for new business? Or sorry, closed session. 11.1, staff parking at Black Creek Pioneer Village. Dr. Trupwood? Are there any items for new business? Okay, seeing none, we will go back to 7.1, which is the 2022 unfunded priorities, and this item was held by Vice Chair Heath. Go ahead, Jack.
Well, thank you very much, Madam Chair. This is really important, and there's 5 or 6 pages of it of unfunded items that this board, this authority, has clearly adopted at one point in time in the past, they discussed all of them. Every single one of them is something that that we have thought is very important and should be done. But then, of course, they're unfunded. I would want to say, Madam Chair, that it's almost as if we shouldn't be adding any more projects unless they're almost emergencies, until we crack into this a little bit more. There is in the budget, there's a recommendation, and I believe here in the unfunded priorities, they're to take 3 or 4 out of them because they've been funded, they'll be funded one way or another. But that only removes the last page, which I think is page nine. We get back down to 8 pages. And I actually think that that we should ask our staff in this area of how to at least address the priority items, which there are several in here about dams and erosion. Those clearly are priorities. And given that we are running a little, we're running surpluses and things like that because of COVID, one can't help but wonder whether or not we have the money to do at least those concentrate on those. I don't think any of the regions or the City of Toronto would be upset if we were to take a little bit of a shift and say we've added these into things that we're going to do in the next fiscal year or this fiscal year. Anyways, thank you. I see John is preparing an answer.
Go ahead, John.
I'm not sure what the question is, but
the question is, can we do something? Can we? Well, the point I made is, we should try not to be adding to this list. And can't we, in the next year, find a way to at least take care of the highest priority items on this list, which are dams and erosion? Devotes money in that area this year.
Through the chair, I better understand the point, and I can tell you and assure you that it is extremely important that we have the list. We have attached some prioritization to it as a senior leadership team to reflect some of your earlier comments on this, Jack, in earlier earlier iterations of the unmet needs list. What we've found is if it's not on the list, it's something that, you know, isn't prioritized, and it being on the list and associated with that priority has been very helpful in concentrating our efforts on senior government funding opportunities, the programs that are coming out from the federal government, the replenishment of the Disaster Mitigation Adaptation Fund as an example, or the water erosion control, the WECI funding from the province. So this is absolutely a priority for us to focus in on those flood control structures and in particular. So we have put a prioritization ranking on it, and it has been helpful. And I think, Michael, if you wanted to add to some of that, just to, stress, we also, too, Michael and I are also hopeful that the list doesn't get bigger. But when we do our asset review work, and Alex and the team, and as they embark on some of this, we find things, and usually they're not good surprises. It's not like a Kinder surprise. It's like a bad surprise. And so we're trying to... obviously keep the list as robust, but with as few items. But there are things that do come up or are made a priority based on our risk assessments and our analysis and everything. So, Michael, can you add to that, please?
Absolutely. And through the chair, I think that this list has been really invaluable in being able to go back to our upper tier and lower tier municipalities on an annual basis to say these are things that are within your jurisdiction that are priority projects. And how can we work together to fund those projects? To your point, Jack, the things that are A and higher priority, we're trying to find ways to fit those into municipal budgets to support our initiatives going forward. And we are very mindful when we are adding to this list, knowing that the list A could be daunting, but at the same point, if we don't put it on the list, our partners don't know that these projects or services are things that are required.
If I might comment, I assume, Michael, and I could have printed this a little larger, I'm squinting to read it. I assume even in the A category, which are priority, you've ranked them internally within the A as well, because you put the Palgrave Dam at the top, and that's certainly not alphabetical. Should I make that assumption?
That is correct. The order that you see here is in order how they fall within our rankings.
Madam Chair, this authority is the best in the province, and we have our leadership role in many areas. But I almost feel that we should be, as new projects come up, but look at the A list. The A list goes on to, also the top of page 3. Middle of page 2. I almost feel that our priority has to be getting the A-list, or the vast majority of them. You can see that there's some funding for some of the A-list proposals out to year 2031. I almost think we should be prioritizing how to get these things off the list as soon as possible. And when we're discussing new projects, who am I to worry about this? To be talking about this is unfunded and it's going straight on this list. I worry about it. I worry about anything catastrophic ever happening, and I'm sure that would be the emergency funding, but how long it's going to take. I also know that, and I will ask the question when we get to the TRCA 2021 unaudited returns, etc. I want to make sure that we don't have surplus money that could be used in this area, some of them are internal, but you mentioned flood control, especially the dams and erosion and things like that. I'm going to ask that question when the other comes up. Anyway, thank you. I'm glad we talked about it. I'd recommend to John And Madam Chair, I don't know if you're eligible for another term. I hope you are. You're doing a great job. I would almost want to spend a little bit more time when new projects come up talking about this list in the context. And the fact is that this new project will go on the list as I'm making it up. I don't know what it might be, as a D on the list. It's not going to be up in the A section unless it happens to be something that's really serious.
They already got to it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right in the beginning. I just emailed June.
Sorry, excuse me. Thank you. Go ahead, Jack.
And through the chair, just the one last thing, Jack, is when we're looking at funding and grants, depending on the program, it doesn't always go to A. So case in point, federal funding on some of the community work that's currently out there, it might be a C or D on the list because it's not necessarily a dam or something that it would be top of mind if we were to get funds, but they are things that help progress our organization forward and do help our sites. So that's the other thing I'd be mindful of. Sometimes it's really important that we're adding because then it helps us leverage funding.
And I agree, I don't disagree. Back again, I plan to not say another word, but I think of some of the projects over the years where we decided to restore this facility that had not been restored in the last decade or 15 years or what have you, we're going to do that, etc. Well, I question, when I look at this, I wonder whether or not we should have been pouring more money, even though we get grants, etc. The grants are dependent on us spending money as well. Putting more into here and advancing, getting rid of those that are 4, 5, 6 years out before we're finished the project. Anyway, thank you. I've moved it, I think, or somebody moved
it. I have a question, please, Councillor Fletcher, thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jack. Councillor Fletcher, go ahead, please.
Yes, thanks a lot. I just want to know, these are our unfunded priorities. How would we rank where these sit as priorities for the host cities?
That's an excellent question. And I think there's an art, a science, and it's a bit of both, Councillor Fletcher. We really are working with our partners very closely on a lot of this. And so for example, in the city of Toronto, we absolutely are looking at, and we have our regular quarterly meetings with Toronto Water's senior management team, Lou and team, and you know, with PNF&T, we try to put our priorities and our list together with them. And again, this part of this is a communication tool too, where we use this list and they're aware of our priorities then become there. So there is a lot that does reflect those discussions built into this list. Is it their highest priority? It may not be. You have a massive transit requirement in the city of Toronto, and we're really focused in on our mandated areas. So it is something that is a bit of an art and science. Michael, do you want to add to that?
I got it, but I'd like, thanks, I don't want to take up too much of your time. I wonder if you could rerun the list by location, please, Madam Chair. Could we have that rerun for our meeting? So it's all of York, all of Peel, all of Toronto, we can just have that. So it's easier to see what's unfunded. And some things may be actually for the city or for city council, but not for city staff. So as councillors, we can have a look at something and see if we want to really advocate for something in particular. So I'm just going to ask if that's possible through you, Madam Chair.
Michael's nodding his head yes, and maybe what we can do is we can just rerun that list and email that out to the board members so that they have it in that format.
And well, Madam Chair, is that how it would come to the board meeting then, correct? It would be redone in that format. Thank you.
So what I'm thinking through the chair is if we could keep the prioritization, because I've also heard from Vice Chair Heath that that's important to have all the A's and the B's and have that listed. But maybe, perhaps, Michael, if it's not too much trouble to add that recategorization or add it based on this, the upper tier, is that okay?
Yeah, absolutely. The intention was to bring it to the upcoming regional board meetings with the councillors, but I'm more than happy to rerun it for the board.
for the
so
board.
So just on that.
You have two attachments, or two appendices. Okay.
Yeah.
I'm assuming it's in a format, like an Excel format, where you can run by priority, and you can also run by tier. So if we could get things both ways, I think that would be very helpful, for particularly for us who, as I tell everybody every time, have 106,000 constituents who call me all the time. So easily read things are really, really important, Michael. Thank you. And then just I'm looking at the SNAP program. Is that not funded at all now, or is that an expansion that's a priority that would be not funded?
The SNAP item on the list would be an extension of the program.
Okay. And where does our Tommy Thompson Park, I think we've had that in for a long time, and that is to try to get, I guess it would be, I don't know what it would be that would get people down there that have mobility issues, but forever looking at how to get people to the spit that for accessibility, if you can't walk, how would you be able to go? And I think that was a $300,000 a year line item that has been rebuffed quite a few times. So I'm just wondering where that sits now.
John?
He's having
You're
trouble
muted.
Unmuting there, I think.
Can't hear you.
Sorry. Through the chair, I'm madly going through the list too, as well, looking for that. Michael, do you see that? And you're talking about the assistance on.
I'm talking about
the shuttle. The shuttle
what,
is that shuttle, the shuttle?
That's what
the
it's
shuttle.
Called. Correct. Yeah.
The shuttle.
Yeah.
Okay. Just want to confirm that.
I'm gonna have to go and review afterwards. I thought that the shuttle was taken as a separate item to City of Toronto. I'm not sure that remained on the list.
That's helpful. Okay, I'll follow up on that because it's not accessible unless you ride a bike, or somebody. Drive sure something. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there any other questions? Seeing none, 7.1 is moved by Vice Chair Heath. All those in favor? Any opposed? That carries. 7.2 2022 TRCA budget was also held by Vice Chair Heath. Go ahead, Jack.
Thank you very much. You know, I want to say how I've said it before, Madam Chair, how well our staff have done. And ensuring that during COVID, this organization remains vibrant and active and financially viable. We are, when you look at page 2 of the report, it comes out at you in spades. There's table 1 and table 2. And obviously with revenues down, you have to make sure that your expenditures are down. You just don't blithely spend all the money and then find out that you're, in this case, $59 million short in revenues, and you spent the expenditures as the budget was approved. So that's where accolades go to our staff in the financial area, and just to say, and the lead from John and Michael on down. I would like to hear a little bit of an explanation from Michael on table 1, you know, why the revenues were down and how you cut back on expenditures. And then the operations, you know, with the revenue, the aspects of revenues that are in the budget and what was expended, it was 1.9. That's within 5 to 10% or 5%, I think. And I'm not worried about that, given the work in the capital area. But maybe on the expenditures, how did we do that? Maybe Michael could answer that.
Go ahead, Michael.
Sure. And through the chair, I think some of the answers that you have are in report 9.2, which we'll get into a bit on the variance side of things. I think you'll see in this report when we're comparing actuals to budget for 2021, on the operating side, we actually made more money than expected, and that's primarily driven by some of the filming and some of the parks education things that were driven from it. on the capital side, it's not necessarily that we didn't get the funding. It's more just timing of projects, which is really spoken to in 9.2, whether there were delays and certain things happening, or just timing of projects, not contracts or that sort of thing being signed until later in the year or until 2022. So what we found historically is, I mean, staff do a tremendous job of managing the budget, don't get me wrong, but we're very close when projects are getting delayed, the expenditures are getting delayed. It's not like there's work going ahead of that. So that's what really drives the primary variance between the actual and the budget.
And I accept that timing is very important for an organization like this. How you time the expenditures to match the revenues as they come in. So, could you explain? I've got the attachment one, capital budget expenditures, and on page 2, it's corporate management and governance budgeted expenditures 40 million, actual 16, difference 24. Exactly what was going, what happened there, what's going on there?
Go ahead, Mike.
The three words is administrative head office. So it's really the delays that were encountered due to COVID in that respect.
So it's delays in head office. But how much money would, I mean, even if head office is happening, how much money would be going out the door?
The administrative head office in total is $65 million. Originally, when we were putting together the budget for 2021, the anticipation was that a tremendous amount of work was going into the project to get us closer to the finish line. And as the team on the call is aware, we're now closer to the finish line for very end of 2022 or beginning of 23.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Councillor Fletcher, go ahead.
Yes, just another money question. As far as just the layout's concerned, compared to capital costs versus operating costs, we're not laying that out in that way that I see right at the moment in either of these reports. Is that right? Or am I missing that?
Michael?
Sorry, Councillor Fletcher, I'm not sure I understand the question. We do have a breakdown between our operating budget and the capital budget with this.
Oh, yeah, I'm just going back at the one we passed and looking at Tommy Thompson. That's a staff request versus a capital request, right? Operational versus capital. But so they're all in one place in 7.1, but you've got them separated out in 7.2.
Thank
Is
you.
That right?
Yeah. Yes.
And the other thing, I just budget-wise overall, the costing for 11.1 that was passed in camera, will we get that information for costing when we get to the board? Actual costing? I didn't see it costed.
Yes, I believe it is costed in the financial details section, but more than happy to discuss that further
camera. Yeah, thank you. Okay.
Good. Are there any other board members who have questions in regards to 7.2? Councillor Fletcher, did you want to move that? All those in favor? Any opposed? That carries. 7.4, agricultural lease renewal, former Lamont property, and this item was held by Councillor Dias. Go ahead, Joanne.
Thank you, Chair. Report's great, don't get me wrong. I just, you mentioned in the report the importance of agricultural lands with respect to food security. And I know that we just looked at this last month for the agricultural land uses and the leases, but I was wondering, given, I guess, the critical issue of climate change, which is in every resident's minds, if next time we review this in 5 years, if we consider lengthening those leases, which will allow these farmers to do some sort of investment into their business. And I know businesses change all the time and they want to grow, but when it's a five-year lease, it's difficult to make any kind of investment. And I just wondered if you'd had that conversation.
John.
Thank you, through the chair. We do have some limitations related to the Conservation Authorities Act in terms of tenure and lease tenure, but it is something that has come up in our discussions as well, just to ensure viability. It's a big issue, and we absolutely want to make sure that there's a balance between, certainty for investment for someone operating on our lands and that, but there are some limitations. And perhaps Alex, if you have any comments on that, you could provide them. Go ahead, Alexander. You there? There you are. Okay, I saw you earlier. Go ahead, Alex.
Sorry, through the chair. Yeah, that's correct, Councillor. There is some limitations with if there is previous provincial money to purchase the properties, but it's definitely something we consider, and we do explore in certain cases, because if tenants are, like you mentioned, contributing significant capital to either a building or a property, they obviously would like to have further terms so they know that the money they've invested in the property continues with the use of the property and with their lease. So it's definitely, we do have those conversations, and definitely willing to explore the next time around as well.
Well, thank you for that. I'm pleased to hear that. And I think moving forward, it should be a priority with discussions with the province if we can do this in the future, because it is really critical to have that food security. So thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Dyes. And I can tell you, this is one of the items that I have talked to staff about and continue to talk to staff about, and the province as well, because it's an issue that I hear a lot about in my community with the leases that they have and the investments that are required. 5 years is not enough. And I know, Jack, we've had those discussions a while with Rouge. So we'll continue to have those conversations with the province and with staff and trying to work with our agricultural partners to give them some comfort and some that they would, the rolling leases will occur for those lands, and that's within the act. That's one of the best ways that we can move forward at this point in time, but we'll continue to advocate.
That's appreciated. Thank you.
Are there any other comments or questions in regards to item 7.4? Councillor Dyes, did you want to move that? All those in favor? Any opposed? That carries. On to 7.5, the Royal Canadian Legion Mackenzie Branch lease renewal. And this item was held by Councillor Jackson. Go ahead, Linda.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and good morning, everyone. Just first off, I just want to thank staff for the report. I just have a couple of questions with respect to the terms and conditions of the lease, and I'm not sure who could answer them for me.
Through the chair, I suggest Alex again, as Alexander, as a point person for answering questions. And if there are other questions about the parking lot and what's going on there too, there's some other folks involved on that issue as well.
Wonderful. Thank you, John. Through you, Madam Chair. Just my question is that on point one, it says that the term of the lease is for 1 year together with an annual renewal option for the next 4 years. I mean, we've had, I think since 1969, some type of agreement with the Royal Canadian Legion in Woodbridge on this. Why is it just 1 year? Isn't that a lot of paperwork? Or is it just annually renew and doesn't have to come back to the executive committee?
Xander?
Yeah, through the chair, we just kept that because that's been the consistent term with the lease since the 60s, like you mentioned. We could always potentially amend it and do a couple more years. We also wanted to grant a bit of flexibility though for the TRCA, because this site may potentially be under a future management agreement with the City of Vaughan. So we just wanted to build in that flexibility. But we've been doing it since the 60s, and we obviously want to continue that relationship with the Legion, whether it's the TRCA or eventually the City of Vaughan.
And through the chair, just to add to that, by giving the 1 year renewal, we do not have to bring it back to the board every year, only at the end of the fifth year when we come back.
Oh, okay, great. Thank you, Michael. That's what I figured. It's 1 year, but then it would be staff would have direction. They could just renew it. It doesn't have to keep coming back to us. You'll have to generate staff reports for us.
Yeah.
Okay. So going through and going down, looking at the rest of the conditions here, I'm looking at condition. Where are we? Number three, that the Legion is responsible for all approvals and costs associated with construction, maintenance, and parking lot operations. My question surrounds maintenance. I've just emailed Jen and or Madam Chair and John some photographs. I was out on site on another matter and was the I understand parking lot maintenance, but what's happening is that the river, the Humber River, is eroding into the parking lot, and it's they've got pylons up, and it looks like a very dangerous situation. I guess through you, Madam Chair, are we saying that the Legion is responsible for fixing that issue? I mean, it's a major erosion issue, which to me looks very hazardous. I'm just wondering if staff could comment on that.
So through the chair, that obviously it's a standard term that people that are using the property are subject to maintaining it and keeping it in good. So that's something that we have as our, you know, standard, and that has been part of the standard arrangement. We recognize that this is an extraordinary situation, particularly because of that part of the Humber and the issues present. TRCA worked very closely with York Region over the last 3 years to create a erosion control fund to help manage some of these issues, or at least to get some funding set aside to recognize the historical development situations and those extraordinary circumstances. So it is a project, and our team is looking at this issue very closely. Matt Johnson, our Associate Director in Restoration Infrastructure, is and the team have been out there, have been looking at this, and they have actually put it forward, I think, on an unmet needs list for consideration. Matt, I'm just wondering if you're available, or Anil, to maybe give an update to Regional Councillor Jackson on that.
Through you, Madam Chair, yes, happy to, John. So yeah, exactly as kind of John mentioned, it's something we're looking at closely. You know, we have some, you know, preliminary designs, but one of the, I think, challenges here, again, it's on the unfunded priority list. And so we're continuing to work with York Region to look at, you know, what opportunities might exist to build it within into the programming. So through that fund that we have, like John mentioned, a lot of it is targeted at the kind of our existing erosion control structures in the region. So that's kind of been the focus with the allocation that we've identified. But this is certainly something we can, you know, investigate or continue to investigate further.
Thank you, Anil, Madam Chair, through you. I appreciate that. And I understand, you know, long-term planning, working with the region, doing, you know, but I think we have a hazard condition today. John, look at those photographs. Jen, look at those pictures. It is sinking down. If somebody trips, they're in the river. I don't know what we can do. I mean, I appreciate that we need to go in and deal with this section and, you know, come up with a plan. But do we not need to take some type of immediate action? I'm not going to look. I mean, I'll leave it with you. I think it's a hazard condition that needs to be addressed immediately. At least some type of fix there. But just one further question, and I also have photos which I can share with you. The trees that are up against the river, which look like they're, because of the erosion, they're starting to tilt and look. And we also have, I think, what I call them widowmakers. They're broken branches that hang across the top, and then if the wind catches them, they go flying. I'm sure there's a proper name for them, but my marriage is to call them widowmakers up at the cottage, so I don't know what they're called, but I think that we need to send our TRCA forestry people in there to, or an arborist to go in and look at our trees, because some of them are on the angle, and there's been a lot of big trees that the branches are broken. So, like, whose responsibility is that? I assume it's ours to go in and check these. I mean, I have concerns with the trees, which I can send you photos, and also with this erosion issue. I mean, you know, not that I'm looking for answers today, but and I'm not going to put it in form of a motion, but I'm going to take it as that we get on this. John, if you could just provide a bit more clarity, I'd appreciate it.
Yeah, through the chair, we do have a program, and we do look at our hazard trees, and there's work underway, and sometimes folks are even, you know, happy or not happy that we're addressing a hazard tree, but there is a program underway. It is something where there is, you know, it's a risk-based program. So the team, you know, takes it into account, and even the erosion hazards, Matt Johnson's team, they take it into account and they categorize it. There's a lot of high-risk sites. across the jurisdiction. But we're happy to look at this quickly. I see our Associate Director Ralph Toniger is on the line. Ralph, do you want to speak to this?
Yes, and through the chair, thank you. I'm not aware of this site currently, but our arborists do actively look at all of our sites, and we have a work plan. Depending on the nature of the property and the agreement, tree management typically falls under the license agreement would have them looking after the trees. However, we do through our programs, there's a lot of sites where we work very closely with the licensee and can provide arborist services. I'm not sure the exact agreement. We'll look into it immediately. We have our arborists on staff, and I know they are constantly going through York Region and can address hazards both by removals or just limb pruning. If the trees are falling into the creek, generally we wouldn't want to remove them immediately because they are still providing some bank stability, and our certified arborists can make appropriate recommendations as to what to do. So we will look back to it. We'll see if this is currently on a work order or the exact arrangement for this piece of property.
Okay, thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you so much. I appreciate that. We need to get out there right away, but we also have to bear in mind that this is a legion, which is holding on financially by their tender hooks. We always talk about how we want to support our veterans, and I really would like for you to get out there as soon as possible and come back. And I don't want you going to them and saying, here's a $10,000 bill, because I will, pardon my expression, Madam Chair, lose my mind. So we need to get out there and have a look. But I really would hope that if you can get a work order put out to go out and look at this erosion and look at the trees in the next week or so, I would greatly appreciate it. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Councillor Jackson. And then I'll just add to that, perhaps once you've conducted your site visit, that you circle back with Regional Councillor Jackson and have those conversations to work out a solution before we include the tenant. Okay. Thank you. There were other questions, Dr. Chopwick, and then Vice Chair Heath. Go ahead, Ron.
Madam Chair, I don't mean to be too informal, but question came to my mind with respect to Councillor Jackson's issue. Where's Richard Eubens when you need him? I mean, here we have a graduate forester, and he's up in that region, and the ex-director of urban forestry in Toronto, a well-renowned professional forester. So, Linda, call for Eubens. Thank you. That's all I wanted to suggest.
Thanks, Dr. Tupper. Vice Chair Heath.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. I noticed this, and the first thing I wrote down was legacy agreement. This agreement really is 50-odd years old. It originates in a time when we would make such agreements. We would not make this agreement today. We wouldn't do it. It takes on responsibilities and costs for the TRCA, which we just heard about, and I'm very sympathetic as well. We would probably, and we just did, in one of the eights, if I'm not mistaken, or both of the, there were three and eight, so I can't recall. At least one, if not two of the eights, we entered conservation easements to ensure that there was an easement to ensure there's no building constructed and a whole bunch of other aspects of it. And that's what we do today. So I turn around and say, I would like us to find a way to get out of this. I don't think that the TRCA, despite my great sympathy for the Royal Canadian Legion and the Armed Forces veterans and all that kind of stuff, I don't think the TRCA should be the bank that assists them And it may be that it should be the region of York or maybe the city of Vaughan, but I would like to find a way that at the end of this agreement that we no longer have to go any further, because this could be very, very expensive. I searched what Linda had. I couldn't find it. Maybe she put it on the screen, but it didn't show up here. But the erosion can be quite serious, and it is ongoing, continue. It doesn't stop. And those costs are significant. They're in the millions of dollars, whereas my sheets were unfunded priority. So I'd like to find a way that we aren't the bank of last resort to do these kinds of things. So down the road, I'm hoping that the region or the city of Vaughan, region of York, city of Vaughan, finds a way to, and we should be working towards that. There should be an easement, and that's it.
I think Vice Chair Heath, I believe in the beginning when Alexander was speaking, he had mentioned that they are working with the city of Vaughan to create a management partnership. I don't know, Alexander, if you wanted to comment on that.
Through the chair, we have been in preliminary conversations with the city. They do have in the future capital plan to extend the trail in the region. That's a few years away, but it looks like eventually it may fall under Vaughan management.
That's good. The word should be from the TRCA that this is the last agreement. We will not be after, this is a 5-year agreement really, with 1-year intervals. It's a 1-year agreement with, I think, 4 follow-up 1-year agreement, 1-year annual renewals. This is it. It should be that we won't be carrying on. It makes me wonder how many other legacy agreements were made back in the early days. We're carrying on, and we become the financial resource for something which we never envisioned. I bet you they never thought of it back in 1969 that we would be discussing this 53 years later. That's all I can say, Madam Chair. Is there anything that does say that, or how do we plan on expressing it? That this is the end, or are we planning on expressing it? John? Somebody?
It's not expressed in the report. I think that the intention is to, over the next couple of years, to work with the city of Vaughan to create that partnership agreement. And I believe that Regional Councillor Jackson would like to speak to that, because that is work that she's probably undertaking as our board rep.
If we want to go in camera, I'm okay with that.
Through the chair, I might add a point just prior to if it's okay, Councillor Jackson. It's just, this is an ongoing discussion with the city of Vaughan. We have our leadership team meets with their leadership team. One of the important items we will continue to bring a little bit more focus on are the property issues in the city of Vaughan, because there's quite a bit, actually even more than Markham. And you know, Jack, about all the Markham ones, there's even more in Vaughan because of our co-management and, you know, lands that are abutting, adjacent, co-managed lands, historical properties in the city of Vaughan, and even OHT lands that we manage on behalf of the province. So there's quite a bit to that discussion that's ongoing with the city, and I think this is one of those properties. There's quite an investment needed on the erosion issue. There's quite an investment to address that particular issue, but there's also a lot of public interest in having accessibility to that parking lot as well, for the reason that it's close to the trail. This part of Woodbridge, there's a lot of interest, et cetera, from the public. So there's a lot to discuss on this, and I don't want to complicate it too much. I know the Legion just wants to have their lease signed, and there are bigger issues that have been identified in a really good discussion about land management and risks and a whole bunch of things have come out today. But I just want to let you know there is that much more you know, comprehensive discussion about lands under the auspices of the new MOU framework from the province, et cetera, that is ongoing as part of our leadership team discussions between the city of Vaughan and between even York Region, because it's this erosion issue on all these lands is a big issue that we have to continue to deal with. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Vice Reid. Councillor Jackson, did you need to say anything else? Or are you okay?
Yeah, Madam Chair, I can just put a little bit of clarity. I'll be very quick. Number one, yes, that is correct. We are working on a master plan for a trail system. As some of you may or may not know, there is a dog park going to be installed in August on lands adjacent to the parking lot to the north of our Veterans Park. We have quite a demand for dog parks. But I also want to make it really clear to members that it's not that the TRCA has been spending gobs of money. I don't think they've spent any money in the last 10 to 15 years. So I don't want people to think that they're going out blowing a lot of money. I don't know whether this could come back, but I don't think they've spent $100. So it's not that we're going out there spending money in the Legion. So I just want to make that really clear. I don't know whether staff wants to provide those numbers, but I appreciate Vice Chair Heath's comments, but I don't want any members to think that the TRCA has been funding the Legion, because as far as I know, they haven't spent any money. And I'm asking for this, that they get out and look at it, because it is their land and it is a hazard situation, and report back. I'm not looking for directing motions to get out there and fix this erosion immediately. I just wanted staff to be aware and go out and have a look. That's all I'm looking for. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you. And that direction, staff direction, is taken, and we are on it. And we have spent thousands of hours of staff time, not thousands of hours, thousands of dollars, but it's been in terms of staff time, putting together some feasibility work to have that ongoing discussion. And yes, I've spent many, many hours with representatives of the community or of, you know, the Legion, and I know other members of my team have too. So absolutely, we'll take that as staff direction, and we'll continue to update you on this as we move forward. Thank you.
Thank you. No other questions? Councillor Jackson, do you want to move that?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you.
All of those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. Move on to 7.8, award of request for tender for supply and delivery of various armor stone for the Humber Bay Park East Reavement Project. And this item was held by Ms. Keller. Maria?
Thanks, Madam Chair. This is a really quick question. I just wanted to clarify that the second and third item here, you only got one bid back. I guess it's a question to staff.
Through you, Madam Chair, that is correct. If we could provide some more information, I'm happy to do. Jet Taylor is here, can provide a little bit more context. It's not unusual in some of these cases where, just given capacity in the supply chain currently, that we're only getting one or two bids, given kind of the volume of work. But that is correct. There was only one for that one.
That's fine. That's all I needed to know. And Madam Chair, my apologies. I had intended to hold item 8.3. I got my numbers mixed up. I don't know if I can bring it back in. Another very quick question. It's already been passed. Yeah.
Yeah. If you want to ask a quick question, and then we'll move 7.8.
Okay, so on item 8.3, what I was struck by was that you got three prices, 300,000, 900,000, and 1.2 million. And so when I see this massive range of pricing, I wonder what's going on here. Now, you discounted the Port Authority because they hadn't met some mandatory requirement, but you would think they knew what the pricing should be, which would be more like 900,000 than 300,000. And so you've said the 300,000 is okay, it's met the criteria. I just was wondering, with this massive range, were you able to explain it, why there would be this, whatever we've got, almost a 400% variation in pricing?
Absolutely. I can take that, John. Through you, Madam Chair. Great question. In this particular case, it's really related to mobilization costs. The successful proponent is already mobilized in the area and is doing work. So there's a considerable cost savings from their perspective on this one.
Okay. Thank you. That's it, Madam Chair. I can move 7.8. Because we can't hear you. At least I can't hear you. Yeah. Sorry.
That was moved by, I was wondering why nobody's hands went up. Ms. Keller, all those in favor? Any opposed? That's carried. The next item on the agenda is 9.2. And the item was held by Vice Chair Heath. Go ahead, Jack.
Well, very quickly, and again, this confirms what we talked about earlier, that there's very good financial management of TRCA. I just wondered whether or not in the year end, whether there's any opportunity to relook again at the unfunded projects, or at least some of the higher ones in the A list, whether we have any opportunities. Partly because of COVID, our expenditures have been down, and some of our revenues are down. But still, we're within what is needed to make sure the revenues exceed the expenditures. Generally, I'm just wondering if there's any opportunities here for the TRCA to address some of those very high priority items that may not have existed in a regular year. I'm looking at Michael, but I don't know who's going to answer.
Go ahead, Michael. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah,
through the chair, more than happy to start. We're always looking at ways, and as you saw in the unmet needs reports, we definitely look for ways to leverage funding so that we're not just spending our own money, but really having a municipal backing or funding and grants in order to support it. We don't want to be accused of using our reserves to fund a certain municipality, upper tier or lower tier, if it's their financial obligation to help in respect to certain of these. So it's something that we're mindful of, but we're always looking at our reserves and seeing how they could be best spent and bringing our guidance forward to the board.
And maybe I'll add to that through the chair is, with a practical example, for example, if we have some amount and we made a decision, you know what, the washrooms are falling apart, and this is something that, you know, in Richard Ubbin's case in conservation lands and something like that, we know that we've got to do something, but then we're also at the same time making sure that the grants team is looking at how that could be a partner and help lever something from the CCRF fund from the federal government, and or in the case of, say, if it's, I don't know, using example, Petticoat Creek, working with the city of Pickering and having mayoral candidate Ash or somebody like this raising this at committee and seeing if we can continue that effort to try to get some funds from the city of Pickering to potentially contribute, which again, we were successful at getting some leveraged funds from the city that went through their budget process over. And again, it's not a lot, it's not the complete answer, but that's a case in point, Vice Chair Heath, as to how we're trying to operate and turning it into some sort of real, tangible outcome within the short term.
Well, I look at some of them, and I'm only interested in flood control and dams and things like that. And one wonders whether or not, I mean, when I look at, and I have the, I pulled the list out again, when I look at the Clairville dam, et cetera, major maintenance. And where is that? That's in Peel. One wonders whether or not an agreement, if we do have the funding today, what you're really saying, unless I'm mistaken, both you and Michael, John, are saying, is that we want to make sure that we have commitment and we collect up to 2028 the monies from the region of Peel. And maybe an agreement with the regional appeal that they will allocate whatever the monies are, or between 250,000, I assume, and 1 million or 750,000 over that period of time would allow us to spend the money earlier and collect it. One wonders whether that's a possibility in the areas of flood control. Because I think, you know, the sooner we correct these and get these off our books as concerns, the better off both we are and the public. Is that ever been broached with, in this case, Peel? I noticed the Palgrave Dam's on the list as well.
Absolutely. Through the chair, this is broached on an annual basis with all of our partner municipalities. A great example of what you just mentioned was the HVAC system at Black Creek Pioneer Village, where we work with the City of Toronto. They didn't have the funds readily available to help us in year, but we had an agreement for them to pay back over multiple years, and we had spent out of our reserves to ensure that the work got done when required.
But I'm talking about a little bit higher priority than Pioneer Village, and that would be dams, et cetera. And I think we may have in our reserves, as long as they're properly covered by an agreement, the ability to do some things, as long as Peel signs on and say they will pay that amount up to 2029. I don't know. Is that, as we have ventured into that area?
Yes, through the chair, again, on an annual basis, we take this entire list to our municipalities. The example I just provided was an example in which a municipality agreed, we had an agreement, and we did spend ahead.
Okay.
And on the region that's Peel, and or for example, on flood infrastructure, it's very similar to what we're saying. We bring this forward and discuss it with them. But at the same time, we're also looking, because luckily there's an intake and there's a program where if we can get a 60%, then, you know, we can get another 40% from the federal government in the case of that particular area, or we can potentially, if another part of the province is underspent and we make the ask for the water erosion control infrastructure funds, we might be able to get some portion of that. There's not much in that, but on the federal side, there's opportunities. So absolutely, Vice Chair Heath, that's the discussion, that's the thinking that we're bringing into those, we're already in the middle of, we're starting the 2023 pre-budget discussions. And so that's where we're at right now, is going into that kind of discussion with them.
Thank you, Madam Chair, I'll move it.
Are there any other questions in regards to item 9.2? Moved by Vice Chair Heath. All those in favor? Any opposed? That carries. Moving into 11.1 regarding staff parking at Black Creek Pine.
We are back live.
Thank you. So we are rising reporting from in camera on item 11.1, staff parking at Black Creek Pioneer Village lot. And this item was moved by Councillor Jackson. All those in favor? Any opposed? That carries. We do have a new motion that we would like to put on the floor, moved by Dr. Drake and seconded by Ms. Keller, that the executive committee request staff to complete a transportation review and an engagement survey with TRCA staff on proposed transportation incentives, and that staff be directed to report back to the board of directors on options for proposed transit incentives for staff. Are there any comments or questions in regards to this?
Sorry, Madam Chair, I'm just wondering if it's more of a transportation demand management kind of policy, because that includes carpooling. So this is a bit narrow. So you can just say proposed transportation incentives and other transportation demand management issues, something like a bit broader wording.
Yeah, I think you need to take a review of parking and
just say transportation demand issues. Yeah, something like that. Yeah.
And then in the first paragraph, that needs to be changed to.
Yeah, because carpooling is good, you know, there's all kinds of other things could be in there. Yeah.
Okay. Is that good for everyone?
Well, the second one is proposed transit incentives should be more general, this, and that staff be directed to report back to the board. That's all we need to say, yeah. That leaves it nice and broad.
On findings, or yeah,
it's just nice and broad. Yeah. I can take it offline with John or Michael or Sarah, Natalie or someone on what I had in mind. Yeah.
Okay.
And Jennifer, yeah.
Any other comments or questions? All those in favor? Any opposed? That carries, and there are no items for new business. The next meeting of the executive will be held on June the 10th at 9:30 via video conference. Can I have a mover for adjournment? Councillor Perusa?
He's gone.
Oh, he's too quick. He's there. He just can't hear me. Okay. Moved adjournment by Councillor Perusa. All those in favor?
Yeah, I'm happy to move adjournment, Madam Chair. Okay, and I'll.
Thank you.